Bill, in the climate change debate, there's no room, there's really no room at all left for empty rhetoric, is there? I mean, you know, I love that Obama showed up at the UN, he gave his climate speech, but you know, just as you write in the things you've written about it, it is blah, 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 blah. It doesn't amount to anything, and we need substance now, don't we?
We do. We need, unfortunately, real leadership, and in some sense, it's unfair to Obama. Here he arrives after 20 years of our presidents doing absolutely nothing on climate. He actually gets a good deal done in the first 6 months with automobile regulations and so on and so forth. But as we approach Copenhagen, it's beginning to look like he's not serious about coming out strongly for the kind of really tough agreement that we need. We're in the last days of this debate because the chemistry and physics is getting way out of control. The Arctic is melting. Everything frozen on the planet is melting. We're seeing scenes like last week's dust storms in Sydney or this week's floods in the Philippines, all the kind of things that come when you have record-breaking temperatures, record-breaking droughts, record-breaking rainfalls. We got to take action now. We know what the bottom line is.
Okay, Bill, let me ask you. Where do we have to get? I mean, this is something people don't understand. It's really simple, isn't it?
It's actually pretty easy.
There's a number, and that magic number is where we need to try to get. We've been wrong about the number before. We've guessed about the number. We've speculated. We've hoped and prayed maybe we were, you know, wrong about our numbers. But we know what the number is. What is it?
350 is the number. 350 parts per million carbon dioxide. 18 months ago, our leading climatologists, led by Jim Hansen at NASA, produced a study saying that was as much carbon as we could have in the atmosphere if we wanted a planet similar to the one on which civilization developed and to which life on Earth is adapted. Last week, Nature, in its lead article, reaffirmed that planetary boundary. This is a very tough number because we're already past it. We're at 390 parts per million CO2 and rising. That's why the Arctic is melting.
Let's talk about some history. Okay, first of all, let's go back a little ways and kind of put this in relative terms.
Sure.
Okay, we know that typically the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has hovered around 270 parts per million,
before
something like that.
Before the Industrial Revolution, for the 10,000 years of human civilization, basically 275 parts per million, give or take 10 parts per million. We start burning coal and gas and oil 200 years ago. That number starts to rise.
We never know where
the red line is.
So 270 parts, basically it's called the Genesis number,
that
the
works.
Buddha number,
exactly
six,
right.
Whatever. Okay, so that's an era we know that things were, the Earth was as it should be.
Exactly.
Now we have parts of the Arctic that are the size of Colorado that are disappearing quickly.
Yeah.
And it's not something that is guesswork anymore. I mean, I know you've seen the films where you have all these climate change detractors that were actually there in the Arctic as one of the huge sheath of the Arctic, part of the Arctic, just melted, just sheared off and fell into the ocean, and they still don't get it. I mean, they were there to make a statement that all is well. And as in the background, you see part of that huge shelf just shearing off and falling into the Arctic. They look and say, well, that's just how it's supposed to be. It's normal.
Yeah, I mean, look, clearly we're past normal. We're like the guy who goes to the doctor and the doctor says, dude, your cholesterol is way too high. You're in the zone where people have heart attacks and the planet's starting to have those heart attacks. That's what happens. That's what it means when suddenly there's 25% less ice in the Arctic than there's been for hundreds of thousands of years. That's why at 350.org we're coordinating what's turning into the biggest day of international environmental activism ever on the 24th of October.
What do you want? You want people to register at 350.org.
It's a website. Right. We want them to do one of two things. Either if there's not an action already underway in their area, and there's thousands of them around the world now in 127 countries and 800, I think, happening in this country. If there's not an action already in their area, then create one. If there is, then find out how they can help and join in and make it bigger. It's going to be an amazing day.
So all of a sudden, what Hansen's been telling us forever, things like the idea that there can be a sea level rise of 20 feet in this century, the idea that the Arctic literally can disappear as, along with all the ice around Greenland, these things are not, they're not speculative anymore. I mean, they're actually happening, and we, but you still have the detractors. You still have the Glenn Becks and the, you know, the real freaks, the real weird freaks out there that are in defense of, basically in defense of the petroleum industry.
Let me, Bill,
I don't know if you know this or not. This is something you might file away for yourself. I know you know that at the beginning of this year, the Chamber of Commerce put like $60 million into this fight for the idea of the fight to stop populism in the United States. So what they did is put some of that money behind people like Glenn Beck, and this is part of the fight. The fight is that global warming is not, that climate change is not taking place.
The good news is that in the last week, three or four of the biggest utility companies in the country have resigned from the Chamber of Commerce, saying they're convinced about climate change. Look, people like Glenn Beck are unteachable on these things because they're speaking out of ideology, not out of science.
No, they're speaking out of money, Bill. They're being paid. They're being paid to say this kind of thing.
Well, at any event, the good news is that ordinary citizens and scientists are beginning to speak up in a new way. That's what 350.org is about, and it's changing the debate. 89 countries now have signed on to this 350 target. That's half the nations that will be at Copenhagen. Unfortunately, they're the poorest countries in the world, the victim nations. So far, the people who are causing the problem are resisting the kind of change that we would need to get back to 350, which is dramatic and tough. But we're going to keep this fight going. We're making enormous progress, as people will see if they go to 350.org.
Do you agree that the numbers that Obama's talking about, I mean, you mentioned, and I think I've seen this observation before, at the UN, he was almost embarrassed to talk about what our long-term goals are, because anybody with half a brain understands that those long-term goals are ridiculously weak. I mean, the idea of by 2050 we're going to have 80% reduction is meaningless. It has no bearing on what the real problem is.
That's a long time out because, you know, we're talking 10 presidents from now or something.
Yeah.
Look, he has to tell us, he has to commit us to a long-term path that gets us back to 350, and the only way to do that is with dramatic short-term cuts. The Europeans have talked about cutting carbon emissions as much as 40% by 2020, which is technologically doable. The Congress
and we're talking about we're talking 15 to 17%
exactly
by 2020. Right. Yeah, okay.
And that's so riddled with loopholes that it's sort of doubtful, but. Yeah, exactly right. This is the problem. We're not doing what we need to be doing. We're not taking this seriously the way we need to be taking it.
Aren't you tired of this administration's words that, you know, and you worked as hard for Obama as I did. I mean, we all were out there doing what we were supposed to do to try to get him elected. And all of a sudden, I'm hearing these words, you know, we can't allow perfect to become the enemy of progress. I'm so tired of hearing that.
Yeah.
All it is compromise babble.
Well, I'm afraid that they sound a little bit like they're pre-excusing failure.
Exactly. They're getting ready for what we all know, and that is they're not behind real meaningful change here.
On the other hand, Obama is such a great communicator that one continues to hold out hope. I mean, if he would fire up Air Force One and put the press corps on it and begin the day in Barrow, Alaska, and finish the day at McMurdo Station in the Antarctic and stop in New Orleans and the Amazon and places in between, by the end of the day, a lot more people would have a more visceral idea of what the stakes are. So I hold out hope that Obama, we haven't heard the last word from Obama, but clearly we've got to push them a little hard.
Let's take a quick break. We'll be right back talking with Bill McKibben on the climate change problem and how Obama's reacting to it.